So good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Transversal Poetry Seminar. It's organized in collaboration between Dr. Klass, the David Rockefeller Center for Latin American Studies, the Romance Language and Literature Department, and the Woodberry Poetry Room. My name is Marcela Ramos, and I'm the manager for the Arts of Dr. Klass program here at the center. I had the very nice and luck. I was very lucky to work with Chloe Garcia from the Poetry Room and Sergio Delgado from Romance Language. So Transversal is a three-day seminar, and if you didn't get one, you can see we have a flyer with all the information about the three events, but it's essentially today, this poetry reading. Tomorrow we have at the Woodberry Poetry Room, we have a translation seminar. It's at 6 p.m. at Lamont Library. And on Thursday, we have the presentation by students and a workshop at Arts at 29 Garden. So today's event will start with a brief introduction by Professor Delgado. Sergio Delgado teaches courses on modern poetry, border culture, the avant-garde, and the relationship between the verbal and visual arts in Latin America. His current research focuses on creative appropriations of consumer culture in Mexico and Brazil, and on violence and the discourse of sensationalism in the Latin American region. He's, of course, from the Romance Language Department. Then we'll have the poetry readings pair by pair, one poet and one translator each coming for more or less 15 minutes. And after that, we'll have a conversation, the six of them, and question and answer from all of you. So, Sergio, I'll leave you. Thank you.
Thank you, Marcela. I'll be very brief. We're here to listen to poetry, so I won't take up too much time. I want to acknowledge and thank the people and the different parts on the different funding sources on campus that made this event possible. First of all, I want to start with my co-organizers, Christina Davis, Chloe Garcia Roberts at the Woodberry Poetry Room, and of course, and Marcela Ramos at the David Rockefeller Center for Latin American Studies. As Marcela said, this is a three-day event, but it's been in the works for quite a while now. And it's been a tremendous opportunity to be able to collaborate with them and what we hope will be a very rich offering of Latin American poetry here on campus and in the Boston area at large. We have had two access to sort of organizing structures from the beginning, the idea and the practice of translation and the idea and practice of transcreation. Today we'll be featuring the work of three poets and their respective translators. Tomorrow we'll be featuring the work of a fourth poet and his respective translator. And on Thursday, we'll move on to the second structure, organizing structure of this symposium, which is the idea of transcreation. I also want to thank my colleagues at the Department of Romance Languages and Literatures for supporting this event. The Woodberry Poetry Room, of course, the David Rockefeller Center, the Provostial Fund for the Arts and Humanities, and the Elson Family Arts Initiative Fund. I also want to thank all of you members of the public for taking the time to be here with us tonight in this rather chilly fall afternoon or evening. And most especially, I want to thank all the students here present, graduate students, undergraduate students. And most especially, I want to thank the students in my translation and transcreation seminar, Spanish 158. We've been working for 10 weeks now on the work of all the poets that will be featured today and tomorrow, and a few others that enrich our understanding of these four poets. And it is through the conversations that I've had with these students over the course of 10 weeks that I've come to any sort of understanding that I have now of the poets that we'll be listening to. So thank you very much. And now, without further ado, I'd like to present our first poet and our first translator. So we'll start with a reading by Washington Cucurto. Washington Cucurto was born in Buenos Aires, Argentina, in 1973, and founded Eloisa Cartonera in 2003. He has published numerous books of poetry and prose, including the novel Cosa de Negros from 2003, and the poetry volumes La Máquina de Hacer Paraguayitos from 1999 and Celar Rayan from 1996. His most recent book is Hombre de Cristina, published this year, 2013. His translator is Forrest Gander. Forrest Gander's most recent books of translation are Watchword by Pura López Colomé, Fungus Skull Eye Wing, Selected Poems of Alfonso de Aquino, and Pinholes in the Night, Essential Poems from Latin America, selected by Chilean poet Raúl Zurita. He has also translated books by Coral Bracho and Jaime Sáenz, among others, and his most recent book is Core Samples from the World, a 2012 Pulitzer Prize finalist. Please join me in welcoming Washington and Forrest.
Cucurto, who is known as Cucu, is going to talk a little bit about the context of his work before we read the poems.
Bueno, estos poemas los escribí hace como 15 años y bueno, tienen poco de poesía en realidad, no están como más basados en otras cuestiones como el cómic y el estilo así rocambolesco. Yo por esos años le había puesto estilo así realismo atolondrado, ¿no? Es decir, poemas donde pasan muchas cosas, muchas acciones, como si fuese un dibujo animado, un cómico o una película, ¿no? Entonces siempre a veces tienen poco de poético, digamos.
So he said he's the champion poet of Argentina and that nobody can touch him.
No. Bueno, este se llama Papá se incendia. Mi padre se vuelve al catolicismo y quiere que yo también me vuelva. Quiere que salgamos esta tarde con una Biblia bajo el brazo a visitar a todo su público pudiente. Mi padre quiere que le ayude a montar un escenario sobre el techo del abasto para que toda la gente lo escuche, para que toda la gente lo aclame. Mi padre pasa hablando del amor de Dios. Ay, Dios mío, tendré que soportarlo. Mi padre pasa elogiando la remera que Daniel trajo de Inglaterra. Mi padre pasa haciendo bromas brillantes. Mi padre, púdico sentimental, pasa recién afeitado. Papá se cuelga del cartel de Coto, le agarra la electricidad y cae sobre el asfalto mugroso. Papá pierde el conocimiento y cree que es Ricardo Celarrayán. Si no estoy mintiendo un poco, ya no odia a Enzo Francescoli. Es más, cree que es Enzo Francescoli y anda haciendo chilenas por el aire. Papá pisa un cable de su escenario y se incendia. Desde abajo todos les tiran baldazos de agua y le dicen, largate, largate. Papá se larga y sale corriendo envuelto en llamas hasta Tucumán y Agüero. Para el colectivo 46, hace bajar a toda la gente y se va con el colectivo y el colectivero de rehén. Papá maneja el colectivo descontrolado. El 46 da vueltas como un trompo hasta que se mete en el rancho A y B, donde los bolitas bailan cumbia. El 46 dejó un gran agujero en la tierra. Papá desapareció. Los ratis de la 21 todavía lo andan buscando.
So he didn't actually say that he was the great Argentine poet, but he said he wrote these poems a while ago that they don't have, they're not formally invested in a formal poetics, but are full of events coming fast and furious, as you'll see. Pop goes up in flames. My dad goes back to his Catholicism, and he wants me to go back too. wants us to leave this afternoon with a Bible tucked under his arm to visit some well-heeled audience. My dad wants them to help him mount a diorama on the roof of the Abasto Mall so that absolutely everyone listens up, so that absolutely everyone goes wild. My dad walks around talking about his love of God. Jesus, I don't think I can take it. My dad goes around extolling the shirt that Daniel brought back from England. My father goes around cracking brilliant jokes. My father, sappy and upright, walks around freshly shaved. Dad hangs up a poster for Koto Supermarket, grabs the electrical wire, and collapses to the filthy pavement. Dad loses consciousness, and he thinks he's Ricardo Zararayan. If I'm not lying just a little, then I don't despise Enzo Francescoli. What's more, he thinks he's Enzo Francescoli, and he starts making scissor kicks in the air. Dad steps on a cable in his diorama, and he bursts into flames. From down below, everyone throws buckets of water, shouting at him, "Move away, move away!" Dad manages to move and takes off running, enveloped in flames, all the way to Tucumán and Aguero, where the 46 slows for the crowd, and he leaps onto the bus and takes the bus driver hostage. Dad drives the out-of-control bus, the 46 spinning like a top, until it careens onto Ranch A and B, where the Bolivians are dancing cumbia. The 46 leaves a huge hole in the ground. Dad disappeared. All of the rest of the 21st, they were still searching for him.
Este está difícil este. Asalto de la Gandhi se llama este poema y Gandhi es una librería de Buenos Aires, bueno, librería Gandhi, ¿no? Entonces, este poema habla del robo que ocurre en una librería. Bueno, mucha gente seguramente, ¿quién no entró alguna vez a robar un libro a una librería, ¿no? Nunca habías estado, Ricky, en semejante estado deplorable, con 50 peruanitas y el Enzo. Nunca te lo hubieras imaginado, Ricky. Jamás pensaste en el ruido de la caja de chapa. Pero ahí estabas, soportando esos conchazos, el fuego de la admiración limeña. Con este calor, Ricky, tendrás que esperar hasta el próximo invierno. La caja de chapa del celular se movía de un lado a otro al doblar las esquinas. Y eso hacíamos nosotros. No veíamos la hora de bajar. El Enzo sacó de su pantaloncito número 9 una ganzúa y forzamos la puerta del celular. El Enzo voló como un avestruz. ¿Dónde nos llevan estos botones? ¡Qué gente! Estábamos en pleno Corrientes y Paraná, pleno centro. Con el charrúa goleador nos metimos en Gandhi. Había una mesa llena con los libros de Juan L. ¿Quién le puso Juan L? Esos rosarinos que no conocen el río. El Enzo se llevó los tomos de En el Aura del Sauce, y Aura era corrido por un sauce, un vendedor alto, con barba y pelo largo. Salimos corriendo a todo lo que da. El Enzo me pasaba el libro a mí, y yo se lo pasaba de nuevo. Otra vez Jesús, se me pone la piel de gallina. Chui, 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 qué fresquete. Jesús del mármol, vení gallinita, vení que acá tenés a tu stopper, animate al gol y te parto al medio, vení gallinita, vení que acá tenés marca personal. El lungo venía pisándonos los talones, de repente al doblar por Montevideo, vemos el celular con las puertas abiertas y Ricky tratando de zafar de las peruanitas. ¡Qué desgracia! Era la única manera de perderlo al lungo ese, que si nos agarra nos mata y nos entierran con Juan L. Así que nos subimos de nuevo al celular. ¿Podés creerlo, Ricky? Escapar de un celular para volver a entrar. ¡Qué locura tan loca! ¡Qué gente!
So this one has a good translation problem in it when he's got several of them. But, Jesús de Marmal, Jesus of Marble. Tom Waits has a song that's about a chocolate Jesus, but we don't really have, you can't just shout out, Jesus of Marble in English. Assault on Gandhi. You've never, Ricky, been in such a deplorable state with 50 Peruvian girls plus the Enzo. Never could have imagined it, Ricky. Never imagined the noise of the panel truck. But there you were, checking out those hotties, the fire of Lima's admiring eyes. But with this heat wave, Ricky, you'll have to hold out until next winter. The cell phone truck was weaving from one side to another, from street corner to street corner. And that's what we were doing. We couldn't wait to get off. The Enzo drew a pick from his number 9 jersey, and we jimmied the door to the phone truck. The Enzo flying around like an ostrich. Who were those morons hauling us? Those idiots. We were at Corrientes and Paraná, right at the center. With a Uruguayan striker, we made our way to Gandhi. There's a table full of books from Juanele. Who put the Juanele crap there? Those Rosarians don't know squat. The Enzo nabbed copies of In the Aura of the Willow. The aura outrun by the willow. The sales clerk, really tall, with a beard and long hair. We took off like a scorched dog. The Enzo passing the book to me and me passing it back to him. Jesus, intermediary Christ. It gives me goosebumps. Achoo, choo, choo. It's chill-y. Jesus, but Jesus. Jesus, but Jesus. Bring it home, hens. Spot that baby to the center half. Go for the goal. Stomp the fuck out of him. Bring it home, hens. Do it with some damn finesse. Stretch shows up hot on our heels. We're suddenly doubling back through Montevideo. We see the phone truck with its doors open and Ricky trying to extricate himself from the Peruvian girls. What a disgrace. The only way was to lose the book back to that beanpole, because if he grabs us, he'll murder us and they'll bury us with Juanelli. So we climb onto the phone truck. You better believe it, Ricky. Escaping the phone truck just to board it again. What wacko craziness. What idiots.
Eso es realismo atolondrado de verdad, ¿eh? Lo reescribiste como hoy hablabas en tu charla, ¿no? No, lo que quería aclarar, porque si no no se entiende un poquito, es que el Jesús, bueno, yo le dije en una parte del poema Jesús del Mármol, era porque había un librero que es Luis del Mármol, se llama, digamos, y tenía fama de como que agarraba a todos los ladrones que iban a la librería a robar los libros. No, y una vez yo vi, cuando entré a la librería, vi que él salía corriendo persiguiendo a un ladrón. Y es alto y tiene barba, ¿no? Entonces por eso yo le ponía a Jesús, claro. Mañas. Mi abuela viene corriendo dispuesta a apretarme el cogote. Apretarme el cogote con tanta fuerza hasta que se me quede seca la lengua y no bote de ella ni un hilito de sangre. Mi abuela viene corriendo por la calle Jean Lloré, pero es tan burra que se cae y se rompe la cabeza contra el piso. Esto me lo hice por vos. Repetían los adoquines que la vieja traía en ambas manos para arrojármelos por la cabeza. La abuela viene corriendo por Jean Lloré y ojalá no le haya dado por tirarse encima de los autos, por aguantarse el aire en los pulmones, hasta quedar hinchada y roja como un tomate y tenderse en medio de la calle. Eso le da siempre de pura impotencia que siente al no poderme alcanzar. Entonces, para que se levante y no la reviente un auto como a una palta, me dejo alcanzar. Y es ahí donde esta vieja chismosa me cae encima y me rompe la cabeza a doquinazos. Eso pasa siempre, pero no hoy, en que abuela vio a Celarrayán y empieza a darle de adoquinazos. Vieja ciega, ese no soy yo, le digo, pero es tan burra que sigue dándole de adoquinazos al Cela. Y viendo que todas las peruanitas vienen en su auxilio, me corro y ligo de emboquillado un adoquinazo de sus fans. La cabeza me queda dando vueltas, pelada y abollada, y así todos los días, y así todas las noches.
Tricks. My grandmother runs up ready to squeeze my neck. Squeeze my neck so hard my tongue goes dry and she won't let up until there's a trickle of blood. My grandmother runs up Yanyuri, but she's so crotchety she falls and smacks her head on the ground. This I did for you, mumbled the cobblestones. The old woman was wielding in both hands to fling at my head. my grandmother runs up Yanyore, and hopefully she's not hurtling the roofs of cars or holding her breath until her lungs go bloated and red as a tomato, and she's flat out in the middle of the street. That always happens when she feels the pure impotence of not being able to reach me. Then, so that she gets up and isn't smashed like an avocado by a car, I let myself come near. And that's when this snarky old gossip attacks me and cracks my head against the cobbles. That always happens, but not today, when grandmother catches sight of Zelarayan and starts to hurl cobblestones at him. "You blind bat, that's not me," I tell her. But she's so crotchety, she doesn't stop hurling cobblestones at Zela. And then, noticing that all the Peruvian girls are coming to the rescue, I take off running, and I punt the cobblestone at his fans. My head is spinning, peeled and dented. That's what it's like every day. That's what it's like every night. Creo que tenemos que terminar con la primera. So we're going to end with this one. Mañana terrible.
Bueno, tiene como un pequeño comentario que dice, porque no podemos dejar de decir lo que hemos visto y oído. Es un parrafito de la Biblia, Los Hechos 4:20. Una mañana terrible. A las 10 de la mañana, recitando sus mejores poemas, asustando a cajeras y viejas con su aullido, Ricardo Zelarayán era arrastrado de los pelos por los guardias de seguridad, por tirar las espinacas al piso, las bandejas de los kiwis al piso, por destapar los yogures de litro. Ricardo Zelarayán era arrastrado de los pelos por andar como un demonio entre las góndolas, imprimiendo temor y sexo en niños y niñas. Niños que tienen el sexo y el hurto en los ojos. Niñas que gozan del gozo del libidinoso monstruo, que piensan el dulce retorno, fulgor y deleite del virginal ano. El monstruo fue desalojado del supermercado por tener malos hábitos y ser improductivo para la sociedad, para la gran empresa nacional de los Méndez. 2. Para ser penetradas con violencia, se visten las niñas de Salguero. El monstruo, con su terrible pene, las espera, encerrado en una jaula de grueso espesor. Las ve pasar al shopping. El ano se difunde cuanto más sube la escalera mecánica. Todas hacen propaganda del ano. Todas hacen difusión del ano. La escalera mecánica, en el calor del verano, pecaminosa ella, goza y transpira como un monstruo. 3. El monstruo, encerrado en su jaula por tirar las espinacas al piso, la bandeja de los kiwis al piso, mira a las clientas y empleadas de la gran empresa de los Méndez. Piensa en los gloriosos días, en las virtuosas noches, cuando agarraba a una niña de Salguero que inocentemente le ofrecía su delgado, rosado y tierno ano para que el monstruo lo usurpara tenazmente.
This poem, I worked on the translation a whole lot, and evidently I sent every version to my friend, the poet Mike Perot, without really realizing that's what I'd been doing, until he came over to visit me, and then I started reading it to him. And he said, "You know, I know every word of this poem." An awful morning. At 10 in the morning, reciting his best poems, terrifying cashiers and seniors with his howl, Ricardo Zelarayan was dragged by the hair by security guards for dumping spinach to the floor, the tray of kiwis to the floor, for opening the lids of quart-sized yogurts. Ricardo Zelarayan was dragged by the hair for stalking the aisles fiendishly, for striking fear into boys and girls, boys who carry sex and larceny in their eyes, girls who long for the lust of the libidinous monster lost in reveries on the sweet, delectable, and radiant reappearance of a virgin anus. The monster was evacuated from the supermarket for his nasty habits and for not contributing to the society of Mendez National Big Business. 2. In order to be penetrated violently, The girls of Salguero dress up. The monster with his terrible penis waits for them, locked in a cage of strapped tumescence. He sees them go by shopping, their ass cheeks spreading as they ascend the escalator. Everyone showcases the ass. Everyone hypes the ass. The escalator, in summer's heat, corrupts her. She lusts and sweats like a monster. 3. The monster, locked in his cage for dumping spinach to the floor, the tray of kiwis to the floor, considers the customers and the employees of Mendez Big Business. He remembers the glory days and virtuous nights grappling with a girl from Salguero who innocently might offer up her skinny, pink, and tender ass for the monster unrelentingly to usurp.
Gives me pleasure to introduce the next pair that we'll be hearing from, Tamara Comenzain and Laura Healy. Tamara Comenzain was born in Buenos Aires, Argentina. Her poetry collections include El Ghetto, Solos y Solas, y El Eco de mi Madre. She's the recipient of numerous honors, among them a Guggenheim Fellowship, the Pablo Neruda Presidential Medal awarded by the Chilean government, and the Prize of Poetry of the Festival de la Lira in Ecuador. She is currently a professor at the Argentina site of New York University. Laura Healy is the translator of Roberto Bolaño's poetry collections, The Romantic Dogs, Tres, and The Unknown University, published by New Directions. Her translations of Bolaño and other Latin American poets have appeared in Paris Review, Lever, The Nation, and other journals. She lives in Providence, Rhode Island, and is the managing editor of Harvard Review.
Olor a media luna dulzaino, sombra oriental estampada en la losa, en remojo en el platito la factura de la tarde, no me dejes clavada en un bar. Ese señor que me mira leer a los ojos en la borra del café, tu futuro me tiene aterrada, por mí, no me dejes clavada en un bar. Desde el damas espío caballeros, me vuelvo a casa a cada rato, pero sigo aquí, en el bar de al lado. Estoy tan cerca que el barrio saluda mi demora. Las caras coinciden con la numeración que anoté en mi agenda, esa cita perpetua con vos. Desde el damas espío al caballero, en su teléfono celular dice un sí rotundo mientras los ojos se le van. Seguramente es un vecino, aquí hasta el mozo queda en familia, cuando se guarda la propina en tu bolsillito de atrás, tintineo de los secretos tuyos, donde se desfondan pertenencias de nuestro futuro común. No me dejes clavada en un bar, ya te espero y ni siquiera anochezca esa espera larga colgada de la línea, el hola mudo que contesta desde el corazón de su fibra óptica un adiós para este desencuentro. Te lo dije, tu futuro me tiene aferrada a mi casa en tu muerte, en mi colchón, cierro el alma, la devuelvo a su morada y yo empiezo ahora tu recuerdo, ese atadito, un pañuelo de secretos que me deja adentro clavada entre estas cuatro paredes, añorando los paraísos de tu bar.
Sickly sweet smell of croissants, plates stamped with eastern shadow, the afternoon's pastry soaking in the saucer. Don't leave me dumbstruck in a bar. That man watching me scan my eyes in the coffee dregs, your future has me scared stiff for myself. Don't leave me dumbstruck in a bar. From the ladies I spy gentlemen, I go back home from time to time, but I'm always here in the bar next door. I'm so close that the neighborhood nods to my delay. Their faces line up with the numbers I've scrawled in my planner. That perpetual meeting with you. From the ladies, I spy the gentleman on his cell phone saying an emphatic yes, while his eyes wander. He must be a neighbor. Here, even the waiter is family. When the tip is tucked into your little back pocket, jingling with your secrets, where the bottom falls out on the belongings of our common future. Don't leave me dumbstruck in a bar. I'm waiting already, and it's not even nighttime. That long wait hanging on the line, the mute hello that answers from the heart of your optical fiber. A goodbye for this misconnection. I told you, your future has me in its grips. At my home, in your death, on my mattress, I close my soul, put it back in its dwelling, and now I begin your remembrance. That little bundle, a kerchief of secrets, which leaves me inside, dumb, stuck between these four walls, longing for the heavens of your bar.
Los poemas que Laura eligió son todos del mismo libro, o sea que forman como un conjunto. Those poems are all from the same book, Tango Bar. En el bar, el taller, se reúne la Sociedad de Fomento de Palermo Viejo. Bajo un farol, el grupo de arquitectos recrea ese sentimiento de esquina, o mejor, el reflejo infantil de perder en el juego de la casita robada. Es mi casa, pienso, la que está en juego. Mientras el mozo pasa equilibrando seis tacitas al nivel tembloroso de una vereda, abarrotada en la mesa de planos, miniaturas de viviendas, calles cuadriculadas de Palermo que vistas de reojo desconozco. El grupo me mira. Entre mi trazo, el de ellos, intercambia saludos, planta un rápido identikit escurrido en tinta china con el único fin de reconocernos. ¿Es esta, me pregunto, la caricatura del arrabal porteño? Porque estamos todos, también los rockeros, atentos en su taller a otra música. Para ellos no hay barrio que valga una sociedad de fomento. Miran el esfuerzo ajeno como diciendo, no somos vecinos, no somos arquitectos, ni jugamos a la casita robada. Ustedes sí, quédense sentados en la edad de sus veredas, que nosotros, chicos de la calle, vamos a adivinar en esos planos la cuadrícula de nuestro hogar dibujado con otra tinta, lejos de esa pobrecita inspiración de 2x4.
En el taller bar, en Palermo Viejo, the Palermo Viejo Development Group. Beneath a lamppost, the architects evoke those corner vibes, or rather, the childish reflection of losing a game of casita robada. I think that's my home they're playing with, as the waiter, balancing six little cups, moves to the flickering level of a crowded sidewalk. On the drawing board, architectural models, Palermo's gridded streets unknown to my stolen glances. The group watches me. Their stroke greets mine, sketches a quick identikit drizzled in India ink with the sole goal of recognition. I ask myself, is this a caricature of the Buenos Aires barrio? Because we're all here. Even the rockers in their practice space tuned in to a different sound. To their mind, no neighborhood's worth a development group. They watch the alien effort as if saying, we aren't neighbors, we aren't architects, we don't play casita robada, you guys do. Stay seated there in the era of your sidewalks. In those blueprints, we street kids will make out our own home grid, drawn in another ink, far from that sorry little inspiration of 2-4. 2-4 is tango.
Yes, 2x4. That's the tango rhythm. Okay. Otra vez en el bar de las mujeres me tomo la copa del olvido. El tango es macho, cantan mis amigas. Pero según el tango, ellas son musas tristes o se ven como muñecas marchitas de vodevil. Y a juzgar por mí, tan olvidada de mí. No sé si nosotras ahora formamos una orquesta de señoritas, o si son ellos muchachos de antes, los que ahora tocan de oído nuestro repertorio, mientras nosotras, antes también, pero de apurar la copa, ya entonábamos mal.
Again, in the women's bar, I drink the cup of forgetting. Tango is macho, my girlfriends sing. But in tango, they are sad muses or see themselves as withered vaudeville dames. And to judge by me, oh, poor forgotten me, I don't know if we now form a ladies' orchestra or if yesterday's boys are the ones who now play our repertoire by ear, while we, especially now after draining the cup, have always been striking the wrong chord.
Okay, this one, it's a little bit difficult, but there are two voices, so it's a little bit difficult to say it, but let's try. Cuidado en la esquina con ese viejo, crucen chicas de a dos por la vereda de enfrente. Viejas estamos, el cuerpo cuelga del lado de su uso, un futuro flácido que cansa al pasado de tanto te acordás. Señoritas, no se entretengan a su edad con la vergüenza ajena. La esquina está, el colegio está, pero ahora nosotras para los jóvenes estamos viejas, hacemos el ridículo, exhibiendo un sentimiento equivocado. Cuando quiero llorar no lloro y a veces lloro sin querer. Me digo y nos reímos de miedo al pasar junto a él con mi compañera de banco. Pepita y yo, la calle se cruza de la mano, acompáñame hasta la casita de mis viejos, estoy hablando de antes del semáforo. No jueguen más, alumnas, a pasar el tiempo, ninguna se quede mirando a la niña de sus ojos. A él no lo miremos, ni locas, nosotras dos que nunca más nos vimos, cruzando el aire de las ceras con cuidado, para que no se levante ni un poquito nuestro delantal. Cierro bien las piernas ahora que atravieso en rojo mi avenida más peligrosa, esa calle empedrada sin retorno que ya no se llama Canning, me aleja para siempre de vos. Hoy faltó mi compañera de banco. It's difficult, no?
Yeah, two voices in the song.
Yes.
Be careful on the corner with that old man. Cross the sidewalk in twos, girls. We're old. The body sags from use, a flaccid future that pesters the past with so many remember whens. Ladies, at your age, you shouldn't laugh at others' shame. The corner is there, the schoolhouse is there, but now to the youngsters, we're old. We look foolish displaying a misplaced emotion. When I want to cry, I don't cry, and sometimes I cry without wanting, I say to myself. And we giggle with fright going past him. Me and my seatmate, Pepita and I. We cross the street holding hands. Come with me to my folks' place. I mean the one from before by the stoplight. Pupils, as time goes on, stop with your playing. Don't keep your sights on the apple of your eye. Let's not look at him. Not in a million years. The two of us who never again saw ourselves cross the winds of Las Heras carefully so our pinafores wouldn't lift the slightest bit. I keep my legs tight together now that, in red, I cross my more dangerous road, that cobbled street of no return, not called Canning anymore. I walk away from you forever. My seatmate was absent today.
Rubia, ¿me escuchas? Este es un mensaje donde te digo que soy tu amigo y tiro el carro contigo, aunque ya me haya ido, aunque esté lejos, muerto vivo en tu recuerdo, porque no soy el hombre que esperabas. Mejor quédate esperando que ya llego, ¿me escuchas? Porque al fin la vida es corta y te acelera hasta mí. cuando el violín por fin se corta. Tápame la cara, rubia, no me dejes ver el final, que yo también soy una criatura tuya, tan chiquito y desnudo ahora que nadie en vos me ve.
Blondie, do you hear me? This is a message in which I tell you I'm your friend, and I'm in it with you. Though I've already gone, though I'm far away, dead, I live in your memory. Because I'm not the man you were waiting for. Better keep waiting, for I'm coming here. Because in the end, life is short, and it hastens you toward me. When the cord is finally cut, cover my face, Blondie. Don't let me see the end. For I am also your child, so little and naked, now that nobody sees me in you.
Okay, so we'll hear now from our third pair, Ana Dini and Malú Urriola. Malú was born in Santiago, Chile in 1967. Her books include Piedras Rodantes, 1988, Dame tu sucio amor, 1994, Hija de Perra, 1998, Nada, 2003, and Bracea, 2007. She is the recipient of many awards, including the Pablo Neruda Prize, 2006, and a Guggenheim Fellowship in 2009. And her works have been translated into French, German, and English. She works as a television and film scriptwriter. Ana Dini, Ana Dini's translations of poetry by Raúl Zurita include Dreams of Kurosawa, Purgatory, and Sky Below. Forthcoming also in 2014 is Floating Lanterns by Mercedes Rofe. Her translation of Gabriela Mistral, Nicanor Parra, and Marosa Di Giorgio have been published in such journals as the Paris Review, Bomb, and Harvard Review. Currently, Dini is writing a book about the poetic structures of solitude and history in Latin America.
Antes que nada, quiero agradecer a Marcela Ramos, a Chloe García, a Ana Dini, a Tamara Kamensain también, a Sergio Delgado. La poesía para mí siempre ha sido un acontecimiento y bueno, sigue siendo así, ¿no? Es un camino el que uno llega, no sabe con qué se va a encontrar, con quién se va a encontrar, ni para qué vino, que es una pregunta, ¿no? Voy a comenzar a leer antes de... del video, un poema de mi primer libro que se llama Piedras Rodantes, un libro que apareció en Chile en 1988, el último año de la dictadura militar en Chile. Y bueno, se llama Propuesta. La Malú me dijo, oye Urriola, evita el cigarro. Quedarte sola en el techo fumando es para volverse loca. Evita las playas en invierno. Las olas acostumbran a aumentar obscenas nostalgias. Esquiva a niñita jugando al luche, tu cuartucho solitario. Esquiva ventanas, gatos y sobre todo los techos sobre todo.
This first poem is from a book called Rolling Stones that was published in 1988. A proposal. Malú, she told me. Listen, Urriola. Avoid cigarettes. Smoking on the roof by yourself will make you crazy. Avoid beaches in winter. The waves always augment obscene nostalgias. Stay away from little girls wrestling. Your solitary dump, stay away from cats, windows, and above all, roofs, roofs, above all.
Del libro Nada 2003. Cuando las palomas han emprendido el vuelo, no queda del vuelo sino el recuerdo. Este libro es un recuerdo. un recuerdo que quiere salir interfaz. El alma aúlla como un lobo que ha perdido la pata en la trampa. Este libro es un espejismo, un reflejo, un pensamiento incoherente, una silueta que me arranca del implacable día, una situación particularmente vulgar que ni siquiera merece la pena recordarse. La muerte y yo, por citar al recuerdo, de vez en cuando arrojamos la ropa por el suelo y mientras sus manos desabotonan mi camisa, yo acaricio los largos cabellos canos que cuelgan hasta sus caderas.
These poems are from a book called Nada that was published in 2003, and Nada means nothingness. When the doves have taken flight, only the memory of that flight remains. This book is a memory that wants to come out interface. The soul howls like a wolf that's lost one leg in the trap. This book is an illusion, a mirror image, an incoherent thought, a silhouette that drags me out of the harsh day, a particularly vulgar situation that isn't even worth remembering. Death and I, to cite the memory, throw clothes on the floor now and then, and while his hands unbutton my shirt, I stroke the long gray hair that falls to his lips.
La que aspira el humo de Blackie, la que escucha la trompeta de Davis reventar los vidrios, la que sueña que escribe, la que cree que escribe, del abismo a la casa, de la casa a los platos, o plat. Nada cambia tanto, en un ínfimo sentido sabes de lo que hablo. Tiene los ojos amarillos, y en el medio del amarillo la luna de Sidaigo, y la gran liebre que habita en el centro de la luna saltará al fin sobre esta buena tierra. Si una palabra es un fragmento, dime, si al nombrarse todas juntas, las palabras de la muerte cesarían, las del hambre, las de los que sueñan contra el pavimento. El cielo de Chile es una cosa indescifrable. La cordillera recortada contra el cielo es de una belleza fatídica. El mar de Chile que se mece esperando lo sabe.
The one who breathes in Lucky smokes. The one who listens to Davis's horn break the glass. The one who dreams that she writes. The one who thinks she writes. From the abyss to the house. From the house to the plates. Oh, Plath. Nothing changes that much in a minimal sense. You know what I'm talking about. She has yellow eyes, and in the middle of the yellow, Sidaigo's moon, and the great hair that lives at the center of the moon will finally leap on this good earth. If a word is a fragment, tell me, if they are named all at once, will death's words cease? Hunger's words? The words of people who dream against the concrete? The sky of Chile is an indecipherable thing. The jagged cordillera against the sky has a fateful beauty. Chile's ocean that waits, rocking her own self, she knows.
Este es un libro que ha sido el último que publiqué después de una especie de trilogía que estaba compuesta por Nada, los poemas que acabo de leer. Luego viene Bracea y ahora un trabajo que estoy terminando que se llama Abuela, pero ahora de Bracea.
So, I'm going to start first in English and then Malu will read the poems from Bracea that was published in 2007 in Spanish. Bracea means stroke. A butterfly passes by, flying in front of these black eyes that watched the thistle. The butterfly strokes, and stroking withdraws herself far from the white thistle. That's left quivering, like the soul, when pain has its way with her.
so imperceptible that it would seem the white thistle doesn't notice, or the wind. I'm an intruder into the relation that keeps the thistle with the wind, and I envy her, because I would like to be that thistle, embraced by the wind, and not be what I am. A thistle against the wind. It's not the same as the condemnation of being two. If I hadn't seen the butterfly alight above the white thistle, I would have thought the wind were blowing him. But what I think, strangely, has some relation to reality.
Pasa volando una mariposa frente a estos ojos negros que estaban mirando el cardo. La mariposa bracea y braceando se retira tan lejos del cardo blanco que se ha quedado vibrando como queda el alma cuando el dolor con ella hace lo suyo. Tan imperceptible que pareciera que no lo notara el cardo blanco ni el viento. Soy una intrusa de la relación que mantiene el cardo con el viento y la envidio. Pues yo quisiese ser ese cardo abrazado por el viento y no ser lo que soy. Un cardo contra el viento no es lo mismo que la condena de ser dos. Si no hubiese visto a la mariposa florizar sobre el cardo blanco, habría pensado que lo cimbraba el viento. Pero lo que pienso, extrañamente, tiene relación alguna con la realidad.
My sister and I were always united. It made sense to me to be beside her. One was part of the other. We never thought to separate ourselves until my sister told me that she'd heard our father as he wept say that we were a monster. It was then that I thought of it. We dragged our boots to the box of photos and we began to look at them. The one above is when we were about a year old. This one here was taken last year, an afternoon when our father arrived humming a bolero by Los Cuatro Cuartos, and he wanted to have a memory of us. My father used to say that my sister owned our heart because she's the one who always smiled in photographs. I'm an Indian. I believe the camera click robs something I can't manage to define. What I feel, I think, remember, mourn, take pleasure in, at that exact moment will stay formed on a piece of paper. A part of me will be captive forever. Memory won't scratch this out, nor will forgetfulness deform it. Maybe forceful words can free themselves and leave stroking like 100 butterflies colored black and blue, dispersing themselves through the air, freed from this vile prison. Each time someone dreams, a caterpillar's born. When the dream comes true, the caterpillar is reborn as a butterfly. And depending on the color, it will speak of the dream that was granted to then die. They are the beautiful and fleeting proof of a dream, my mother said. It's like lightning. That's why words that no one looks at light up, my other mother responded. I don't know what I dream. I dream less than my sister. I don't believe in the things that my sister believes in. She ignores that she's a monster, not me. The stars remind me every night that I'll wake up. And when the stars stop shining, they'll laugh about us in town.
Mi hermana y yo siempre estuvimos unidas. Era lógico para mí estar a su lado. Una era parte de la otra. Jamás pensamos en separarnos hasta que mi hermana me dijo que le había escuchado a nuestro padre entre sollozos decir que éramos un monstruo. Entonces lo pensé. Arrastramos nuestros bototos hasta el cajón de las fotos y nos pusimos a observarlas. La anterior es cuando estábamos por cumplir un año. Esta fue tomada el año pasado, una tarde que nuestro padre llegó tarareando un bolero de Los Cuatro Cuartos y quiso tener un recuerdo de nosotras. Mi padre decía que mi hermana era dueña de nuestro corazón porque es la que siempre sonríe en las fotografías. Yo soy india. Yo creo que el clic de la cámara me roba algo que no alcanzo a definir. Lo que siento, pienso, recuerdo, duelo, gozo, en ese momento exacto quedará plasmado en un papel. Una parte mía quedará cautiva para siempre. No la borronará el recuerdo, ni la deformará el olvido. Tal vez las palabras vehementes puedan librarse y salir braceando como un centenar de mariposas de colores negras y azules, dispersándose en el aire, liberadas de esta jaula infame. Cada vez que alguien sueña, nace una oruga. Cuando el sueño se realiza, la oruga renace convertida en mariposa y, dependiendo del color, hablará sobre el sueño concedido para luego morir. Son la constatación bella y fugaz de un sueño, dijo mi madre. Es como el fulgor. Por eso refulge las palabras que nadie mira, contestó mi otra madre. Yo no sé qué sueño. Sueño menos cosas que mi hermana. Yo no creo en las cosas que cree mi hermana. Ella se va de ser un monstruo. Yo no. Las estrellas me recuerdan todas las noches que despertaré y cuando no estén brillando, se burlarán de nosotras en el pueblo. Gracias.
Before we finish, I would really like to thank the Woodberry Poetry Room and Dr. Class and Chloe Garcia Roberts, Sergio Delgado, Christina Davis, Marcela Ramos, all of the people involved in organizing this wonderful event. Thank you. And Malu.
So we have some time for questions or comments.
Game show moment.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. It was fantastic. You know, really, really lovely. And it's nice, a nice group to be. A little tough audience, I think. But hey, I have a question for the last lady here. Aflorizar. Is that a thing in Spanish these days? You know, a butterfly lands on a flower and is aflorizar. Is that what that means?
So I translated the word as a light. I translated the word as a light. Because I wanted to capture the sense of light and photography and also the sense of light that comes through in various other poems. But a light specifically refers to a bird or any type of flying insect, a light thing that lands on a branch. Yeah, but it's in the same sense as aterrizar.
Yes, yes. And that's what I was asking.
Oh, acuatizar also, because one of the books we read from is called Nada, which also means to swim.
Gracias.
More questions? Comments?
Yeah, could you just share with us your process for working together, how you carried out the translations, over what period of time, and what level of interaction you had?
Let's start out with Forrest to move down, or Anna?
With Cuckoo, it was all about, for me, it was about Argentine vernacular. Street vernacular, which I didn't know. So I'd keep writing him saying, you know, what about these hens? You know, what's going on here? And he'd always say, oh, it doesn't mean anything. It doesn't mean anything. And then he'd sort of elaborate a little bit and said, well, you know, it's sort of sports and, well, you know, it's sort of sports and drinking. And, you know, these words come up. So that was really fun, sort of putting that together, the vernacular and we had a little bit of an email exchange.
We actually didn't really work together. No. We communicated a little bit about which poems I was going to work with, which books I should look at, what had already been translated. I've only ever worked with dead poets, so I...
Suerte, suerte.
But we talked a little bit today, and it was actually really fun to hear a couple of her... Tamara's feedback about some of the poems. One of them is is the lyrics to a tango, which I actually didn't even realize, so that was kind of fun to know. And knowing that, I'd probably go back and translate it differently. But I sort of just did my own interpretations without really consulting.
She didn't translate the rhyme.
I didn't translate the rhyme.
So I said to her, well, I never use rhyme in this case. It's a lyric, tango lyric, yeah. No? But, well, it's a...
So it's a challenge to go back and put it into rhyme.
So this is my first time meeting Malu Uriola, but I had been reading her poetry for a while. And for me, I have to begin and translating something, and then I leave it in remojo, which means you leave it, like when you wash something, you let it soak for a while, and then you go back to it. And that's, I find, a good way of returning to language in a very fresh way, especially because Malu shifts registers very quickly. And so you have to gain that sense of register change in a way. So in other words, you don't want one register to bleed into another. The other thing is, in her poetry, I found a lot of resonances of other poetry that I had translated before. And so I brought that in as well to reflect just the multiplicity. So I chose words from other poets that I'd already translated. So Pizarnik, Raul Zurita are really obvious. And then U.S. poetry comes in there as well. Obviously, Plath. So...
Y antes de pasar a la próxima pregunta, los poetas quizás quieren compartir un poco de su propio proceso. ¿Cómo fue colaborar con los traductores? ¿Cuál fue la duración de esa colaboración? ¿Y cuáles son sus impresiones una vez acabada esa colaboración?
Porque estoy muerta.
Bueno, con Forrest nos mandamos unos mails. Al principio íbamos a traducir otros poemas de otro libro que se llama 20 pungas contra un pasajero. Y después creo que te envié yo a Celarrayán. ¿No? Que es el libro que leímos, que hizo Forrest, lo mejoró muchísimo la traducción, que es un libro del año 95 y bueno, es un libro que dialoga mucho con la época, ¿no? Tiene cosas, mucho de personajes de la época, y la traducción iba a ser, yo se la tiré, se la mandé a él como algo bueno, si es buen traductor a ver que traduzca esto, ¿no? Y de cierta manera es algo intraducible, realmente es muy, muy complicado. Y bueno, vos lo decidiste hacerlo. La verdad que fue una aventura, un desafío, porque entiendo que es un libro... yo sabía que iba a ser difícil.
Yo lo único que sí quiero decir de Lora es que ella me escribió y yo le dije que decida ella qué es lo que quería, le gustaba traducir, porque me parece que... Es muy importante también, hoy se habló en la otra reunión que tuvimos del gusto por la traducción, ¿no? Que es muy importante que a uno le guste o le atraiga lo que va a traducir. Y entonces me llamó la atención que ella eligió, se jugó por uno de mis libros y un libro que yo tenía un poco olvidado. Y le agradezco mucho porque es como que lo redescubrí también con el hecho de... tener que volver a enfrentarme con ese libro, bueno, dije, yo escribí esto, bueno, puede ser, ¿no? Y eso es muy interesante también en el proceso de, de, donde a uno lo traducen, que es un modo también del lector. O sea, el traductor es un lector como cualquier lector que elige algo por determinadas circunstancias y se mete ahí, ¿no? Y eso siempre nos asombra a los escritores. Es un asombro para nosotros lo que el lector ve ahí también.
Bueno, yo como decía al principio de mi lectura, el camino de la poesía siempre es un camino de acontecimiento, ¿no? Yo estoy pensándolo desde la más básico de la filosofía. Entonces, para mí fue este camino con Ana fue y sigue siendo un camino de descubrimiento. Hoy día estuvimos hablando en breves segundos sobre la musicalidad de los textos y cómo hay textos que a veces primero uno escucha la música y luego piensa, ¿no? Luego piensa todo, la vida, la realidad, qué sé yo. En cambio, hay otros textos que nacen del pensamiento y donde la música viene en segundo lugar. Yo he cruzado música y audiovisual, Ana también. Entonces, el cruce que hicimos, bueno, ella desde agosto que viene trabajando, ha leído todos mis libros, lo cual agradezco porque es terrible leer tantas cosas. Pero el cruce musical y audiovisual ha sido muy, muy, muy interesante, sobre todo porque uno inventa palabras, ¿no? Entonces, inventar palabras como aflorizar o otras que aparecen en los libros, fue bonito discutir sobre cosas que no existen, eso quiero decir. Es bonito discutir sobre palabras que no existen y eso estuvo muy bien en el trabajo con Ana. La verdad, yo estoy muy contenta de todo este acontecimiento de haber llegado acá. Hace muchas veces me habían invitado a Estados Unidos, nunca lo había podido concretar desde el punto de vista experiencial. También caminar las calles de Boston con frío, con la poeta Tamara Kamensan, a quien había leído y no conocía, también ha sido poético. Entonces, estoy agradecida poéticamente de este encuentro con Ana y con todos los que han participado. Eso.
We had a question from the gentleman. Oh, great, yeah.
Ana, you told us a bit about how you've brought in some work that you had already translated from other Latin American poets. And I was wondering for the other translators, what are other ways that you've added to the translation and which ones maybe do you have you enjoyed working with the most or which additions have you liked the most?
Which additions of what?
In times that you have had to Anna was talking about how she had added some words from poetry that she had already translated, and just in the act of translating, we've been talking a lot in Professor Delgado's class about like traición and la traducción, and in what ways, you know, addition can be a certain traición, but also like an enriching or just change. But I'm mostly trying to get at ways that you may have added to the original text in your translations.
I added not a single word to the original text.
I think what I meant was that I would choose a word that, I mean, I would translate a word in a way that resounded another author, another text. So I wouldn't add words. Do you see what I'm saying?
Tonally, finding registers in Cuco's poetry with other poetry, with Mexican poetry that I know, that sort of helped me. And then bringing in slang, like Southern slang, took off like a scorched dog. There's not really a scorched dog in that line because it.
you can't even see it in the Argentine, it's so quick. So drawing on the resources in other slangs.
And I think in Tamara's poetry, there are voices, you know, and especially in narrative poetry, there are a lot of voices, and so you're trying to translate into a voice in English, which is going to be different. And like Forrest said, you choose idioms that go along with that voice and expressions. Mm-hmm. And so maybe the syntax of the sentence might change, which means the line breaks might change. Things do get altered in the English version.
Anna, you translated de India as Indian, and you must have thought about like the different kind of repercussions that would have. What made you choose that?
So Sidaiga's moon is it's an indigenous myth. And so I meant Indian as it would be here. And I thought, okay, well, could I say, I mean, Malu in the Spanish doesn't say, I'm a Native American.
Yeah.
And she doesn't say, soy una mujer indígena. And so really that, you know, that has a direct correspondence. I did think of writing, I'm an Indian woman, but too many syllables.
We got a question from the gentleman.
First of all, I mean, fantastic poems and translations. But I wanted at some point, I guess a couple of days, but to also maybe hear a gloss of what the poets answered in Spanish just now. Earlier, but maybe my question is partly answered, but it was just about this idea, because I did feel in especially in the paired readings of a kind of a drift in the music or this set of affinities, and I know that that's something that all three of you were thinking about now, and it'd be great to hear about that and explore that more.
This is Vivek Narayanan, who is also a translator and studies Sanskrit for...
What Malu mentioned is that we had spoken about music and how the sense that you experience sound before you experience different types of meaning. And so that's one thing. But the other thing is that I think affinities... I think to translate, you really have to understand this poetry. And so, do you know when I said you leave something in remojo, you leave it to sit for a long time, part of that is the process of understanding it. And then once you get to, you understand the structures at play and how this person is moving and how where the emphases are of their poetry, I think it becomes easier over time. But the affinity, I think that the affinity exists in the languages that we're sharing together. That I don't necessarily think that it exists in an affinity of friendships. We're speaking here through understanding one another in this way and also listening closely to one another in this way that we have chosen to listen to one another. You know, then I think over time you get to know someone, but you know them here. This is what it's about.
So Tamara was saying that she hadn't looked at this book in a long time that she had written, and I chose poems from it. And I chose them because they were the poems from this book that I felt the strongest affinity to. It takes place in Buenos Aires, and I hadn't been there in a little while. I'd spent time there before, so I had a nostalgia for it, for the language and the tango and everything. And so these were the poems that attracted me. And Tamara was saying how interesting that was to see which poems I liked, because they aren't necessarily the ones that she would have chosen. And so I think there's an affinity in that, too. Where I didn't just translate any old poems, I translated my favorite from this book. And as Anna was saying, you let them
you need to have that, and you need to let them sit, and you need to understand them, and I agree with that too. So I don't know if that answers the question.
That's good. And for me, it's like putting on someone else's pants. It makes you walk differently. And so translating cuckoo, the sort of rhythms in my head as a poet, as a writer, have to disappear. I have to sort of disappear and put these other pants on and feel what it's like to walk around in them, which in the case of his poems is like taking a bunch of methamphetamine and leaping into the basement. So the affinity I felt most strongly was with how charged his poems are with life. And they're just rammed with life and event and energy. And I could feel that. That was my strong affinity.
No sé si los poetas quieren tomar una oportunidad para responder a la pregunta del caballero que se preguntaba sobre las afinidades de ritmo, las afinidades musicales que surgen en el proceso de traducción y cómo ahí hay una oportunidad de reencuentro y reconocimiento para los ritmos propios de su poesía y la creación de afinidades entre esos ritmos propios y los que surgen del proceso de traducción. Claro, sí, pero para los que tuvieron colaboración.
Bueno, está mi caso, que lo hablamos recién, que yo le dije, vi que Lora me dijo, yo le dije, ¿viste este poema que en realidad estoy parafraseando y rehaciendo unas letras de tango? Entonces ella me dijo, ah, no sabía. Entonces le digo, va rimado, esto va rimado. Y ella me dice, ah, no, claro, yo no lo rimé. Pero si ella hubiera sabido que yo parafraseaba letras de tango, lo hubiera rimado, porque la lírica de los letristas, en general, los letristas de música, riman. Entonces ahí hay una cosa posible. Y yo le conté una anécdota, que la puedo contar, que cuando salió este libro, la primera crítica que salió en un periódico era más o menos negativa, más o menos no, pero lo que sí decía como muy malo era, pero qué rima tonta en ese poema. O sea que el crítico no se había dado cuenta que yo estaba parafraseando la letra de un gran letrista de Villépole, un gran letrista de tango. Y entonces, bueno, en ese sentido le dije a Lora que no se preocupe, que ella no se había dado cuenta, porque ni siquiera el crítico ese se había dado cuenta. Pero había dicho que era una rima tonta.
Sí. The first review that came out about the book was okay, it was an okay review, but there was one really bad part where he said that this poem just had this horrible rhyme scheme, and it's because the critic didn't realize that she was actually taking the lyrics from a tango and reworking them, and so not even the critic realized that it was tango lyrics, and so I shouldn't feel bad that I didn't realize it either.
Maluco, curto.
Yo creo que ya lo dije un poco. Bueno, yo creo que lo dije un poco, estábamos discutiendo sobre un texto que cómo había sido armado, entonces yo le contaba a Ana que la verdad que a mí me había costado mucho, que no había sido un texto que había salido fácilmente, sino que había tenido un tiempo bastante considerable, y que el ejercicio había sido, como no sé si lo han hecho, que es tratar de pelar una manzana sin que se corte la cáscara, ¿no? Que quede una espiral perfecta, y tratar de construir con esa musicalidad. Entonces ella me dice, ah, sí, porque yo toco piano, y entonces he tocado, y al final terminamos hablando de música, y la verdad es que mi trabajo poético tiene mucho jazz, aunque no se note. Detrás hay una pulsión, hay una pulsión de jazz bastante importante, Lo he dicho en varias entrevistas, Nina Simone para mí, yo no podría vivir sin Nina Simone. Y eso hablábamos con Ana al final, que bueno, terminamos siendo grandes amigas gracias a la traducción. Ahora, la verdad yo siento que la traducción es una reescritura también, o sea, algo de poeta y algo de escritor tiene que haber en un traductor más allá de su rol de lector. Porque las palabras que uno ocupa como autor, a veces un traductor, y lo presencié, digamos, el acontecimiento de la lectura de Curto y Forrest, los dos utilizaron diferentes musicalidades para leer, diferentes entonaciones, y entonces ahí es cuando uno cabe preguntarse si la poesía de pronto acontece para todos nosotros de manera distinta. Para Ana aconteció con este trabajo de tener que traducir algunos poemas míos. Para mí ha acontecido leyendo a otros poetas y, bueno, el trabajo, que era lo que les decía antes, del acontecimiento tiene mucho que ver con lo musical. Yo, mis primeros acercamientos a Nina Simone fue primero por lo musical y después, bueno, me remití a toda la historia que hay musical detrás de ella. Y fue un interés poético, no fue un interés de fans, ¿no? Y entonces el trabajo que hemos hecho con Ana estos meses por mail y personalmente ha sido también en gran parte las preguntas que uno levanta, ¿no? En la escritura y las preguntas que uno levanta en las reescrituras y en las traducciones no tienen fin, ¿no? Eso es lo que me parece más interesante.
Should I translate? Do you want me to translate? Okay. So she was talking about this last book that she wrote, and it was very important for her to think first about the music and then about meaning. And she said it was like trying to peel an apple without ever interrupting the peel of the apple. So, and then she says that her work has a lot to do with jazz and the pulsations that are very important in jazz, and particularly Nina Simone. But that translation, she believes, is also a way of rewriting. It's something beyond being a reader. So, más allá de ser un lector o una lectora. And for example, in Forrest and Washington, when they read, they both used different rhythms. They weren't necessarily the same. They were different, each in their own right. But for her in particular, it has to do with an experience of music. And when she became interested in Nina Simone, it was a poetic interest. It wasn't just an interest of being a fan. And then she finally said that what's so interesting about this work is that it brings up an interminable number of possibilities in readings that she enjoyed. So.
That's an interesting translation. Interminable or endless or?
Mm-hmm. Like it's a nice long word.
More syllables.
Yeah. Five.
Yeah. Bueno, no, ya lo más o menos también lo dije, que en realidad, bueno, no, como verán, no sé inglés, y entonces de la parte técnica mucho no qué voy a intervenir, ¿no? Pero bueno, respondí algunas preguntas que eran raras y bueno, igual me di cuenta, imagino, porque la verdad que no sé, que cuando Forrest se dio cuenta que había como 10 palabras raras por poema, digo, yo no me pongo a escribirlo de nuevo al poema de pronto, ¿no? Y bueno, creo que fue acertado y a pesar de no saber inglés, cuando lo escuché leer, también tuve la sensación de que el poema como que tiene más ritmo y bueno, él se ve que hizo lo que hay que hacer, que reescribir el poema y empezar a entusiasmarse con el texto y bueno, jugar también con como él dijo, ¿no? Ponerse los pantalones de otro, ¿no? Creo que de eso se trata un poco la traducción. No sé vos si está de acuerdo lo que digo, no sé qué. Yo sentí eso, también estoy muy entusiasmado, la forma de leer también te la voy a copiar, que está buena. Con más onda, ¿no? Entonces, lo mejoró en todos los aspectos, digamos.
¿Y dónde está la original en este caso?
I can translate too. It's up to you. You know, you have more experience. I can do it.
Go ahead.
Okay. So this will be fun. Cucurdo was sharing with us that part of his collaboration process involved answering a few questions, a few weird questions. One of the things that occurred in the process of that back and forth between the poet and the translator was the realization on the part of Cucurdo that all of his poems had, you know, a good 10 weird words in them on average, and that, you know, at one point Forrest, the translator, probably realized it was better to just rewrite the poem rather than taking a stab at those 10 weird words per poem. And Cucurdo could tell, even though he wasn't too involved in the sort of technical process of translating the poems, he could tell just by witnessing today's reading that the poem had more rhythm to it. The translated poem had more rhythm to it, and in the end, that's what translation is about. You take the poem and you do what you want with it. You're sort of approach it in a playful way, in a willfully playful way, I didn't take notes for the last two parts. That's right. Yes. So and now you know, he was so taken by the delivery of these translations on the part of Forrest that he has plans to appropriate that delivery method for his own deliveries. One last question, Daniel, or a few last questions, Daniel, please.
Almost answered my question already, but I think Forrest, dear Forrest, you're being very self-effacing. You were saying that you were not. That you were using someone else's pants and even someone else's shoes, and you didn't add a single word to the translation. But as Cuckoo was saying, your reading had a beat to it, which was certainly new. So I wanted to ask you about whether you read the books out loud when you were translating them, before translating them, whether, you know, the music you were talking about was somehow involved in the process of translation. This also has to do with the idea of tradition that someone was asking about before. Were there other musics or voices in your reading of Cucurdo's poetry? To me, you sounded for a while like Frank O'Hara, but maybe that's me reading your poetry, reading Cucurdo's poetry. Okay, yeah. So I believe there are different pairs of shoes here. And I don't know, I was just wondering.
Yeah, it's a shock to me that the pants I thought I was wearing aren't the ones that Washington is wearing. And your question's really interesting. Because it's true, I had a more zen idea of what translation was. I thought I was really disappearing and hearing the music of Cuckoo's poems. But maybe I wasn't disappearing all the way, and what I was hearing was also, write the poems that I know, Frank O'Hara's poems. Do seem to be that sort of same sort of energy, same rammed with life, and this rhythm that I was hearing in Cuckoo's poems maybe were partly a residue in me, and that you never can get to a Zen place where you, as I thought I was doing, really hear the music of someone else's mind
because you can't get entirely rid of your own music. So that's, you've shamed me.
Wonderful. So we had a few more questions, which I invite you to save for the next two events. The first one, or the second one of this three-day series, will take place tomorrow, Wednesday, November 6th, at 6 p.m. in the Woodberry Poetry Room. And it's going to be an exercise in translation, live translation, featuring the work of Peruvian poet Roger Santibáñez and his translator, Brandel Francés Bravo. And as a reminder, on Thursday, we'll be closing our proceedings, the symposium, with the showcase of works of translation and transcreation by the students in my workshop, Spanish 158, Transversal Poetics. That starts at 1:30 p.m., and it takes place in Arts at 29 Garden, which is located at 29 Garden Street. So with that, thank you. Thank you to the poets and translators. Bravo.